Well, our next speaker is probably known to most of you in this room. You'll recognize Roberta Freund Schwartz, who heads the ARSC Awards Committee, a good person to know.
Closer to the mic.
How's that? Uncle, how about back here, Uncle Chris? All right, thank you. She's director of the Musicology Division of the University of Kansas and is a noted expert in the fields of African American music and the Spanish Renaissance. Her book, How Britain Got the Blues, won an ARSC Award for Excellence for her writing on the blues, and she has appeared as speaker here at the ARSC Conference numerous times. Her topic today is the song Tight Like That and the HOKUM Blues Tradition.
I'll try to do this with a minimum of squinting to see things over there, but to get us started.
Do you want the lights down?
Yeah.
Listen there, folks, one thing, a little song. Don't get mad, but don't mean no harm. You know, tight like that. Feel the love, I'm boy, tight like that. Feel the love, I'm hooky, let me talk to you. I need a tight like that.
Though the Chicago blues are most commonly associated, oh, I have a microphone, with the post-war era, they're an outgrowth of an earlier style that took shape between 1928 and 1941. Most writers have argued that little of this music is of any worth any serious consideration, a mere degradation of the robust folk blues into, quote, glossy mechanistic self-parody and tasteless double entendre, unquote. Traditionally, one song has been identified as the root cause of this degradation, a seminal recording of the city blues that some also feel contained the seeds of its destruction. It's Tight Like That, released by Georgia Tom and Tampa Red in 1928. The song has served as a trope for everything that blues purists dislike about the city blues. In fact, Mike Rowe went so far as to quip that the song, quote, might easily have been entitled It's Trite Like That, unquote. The reality of the song, though, is far more complex. The story of It's Tight Like That begins with a rather improbable source, Thomas A. Dorsey, the father of modern gospel music, who had, prior to that, worked in the blues field. Okay, we're gonna hear more than enough of that. Yeah, let's move on. There we go. In his unpublished autobiography, Dorsey claims that he wrote the melody in harmony at the request of a young man, who he doesn't name, who brought him some lyrics that seemed promising. This contradicts several other accounts he gave of the song's origins, where he claimed that Tampa Red, Hudson Whitaker, an associate of his, asked him to write a new arrangement of an old song or an old tune for some lyrics that he had newly written. Quote, Tampa, you know, it was a bunch of us somewhere one night, and there used to be a phrase they used around town, you know, people would start saying, oh, it's tight like that, tight like that. So we picked out a song, and we took it to J. Mayo Williams, A&R man and producer for the race division of Ocalion Records at the time, and he heard it and said, oh man, we gonna record that. According to Tampa Red, the lyrics were new, but the melody was lifted from Papa Charlie Jackson's 1925 hit, Shake That Thing, a song we will return to later. At first glance, Georgia Tom and Tampa Red seemed like an unlikely pair. Georgia Tom Dorsey was a veteran performer who began his career in Atlanta as a barrel house pianist, then served as bandleader for Ma Rainey, as an arranger and vocal coach for Paramount Records, and he also composed a number of successful songs, most famously Riverside Blues. Tampa Red, a guitarist from Dorsey's native Georgia, though born as per his nom de blues in Tampa, Florida, had played as a sideband on a few tracks for Paramount after busking on the streets of Chicago for years. However, the Chicago blues scene was far more closely knit than one might imagine. The Stroll, the entertainment district in Bronzeville, Chicago's black population center, was a 13-block-long section of State Street where respectable cafes, nightclubs, policy houses, sportin' dens, buffet flats, brothels, music stores, and vaudeville houses were concentrated. It was here that African Americans in the music business, and those who aspired to be, congregated and where any number of musical partnerships were formed. Dorsey told Michael Harris that after Mayo Williams heard the song, he and Tampa recorded it right away and that it was rushed through the finishing process for immediate release. This isn't entirely accurate, though the sequence of events that followed makes this an understandable mistake. The pair first recorded the vocal novelty duet in Chicago on September 19th, 1928, Vocalion Matrix 2326, quite possibly the day after they played it for Williams. However, it wasn't issued or assigned a catalog number. They went back into the studio on October 8th and again recorded its tight like that, Matrix C2415, but like the previous take, it wasn't released either. On October 24th, 1928, the pair again was in the studio to record tight like that, Matrix C2476, the version that was finally recorded as Vocalion 1216. As neither of the rejected versions has been located, it's impossible to say why. Though perhaps the two recording veterans, Williams and Dorsey, were looking for some quality that finally emerged in the October 24th session, or Dorsey continued to tinker with the arrangement until he produced one that he thought would catch the public's attention, which was his specialty at Paramount Records. He claimed that frequently, quote, "The writer of the song didn't know what to say at some places for the punch. I would take them then and feel out the words, and then feel the music out and accent them in a way that it would grasp the public and make them set up straighter." While it's tight like that may not have been an original tune, the arrangement of Vocalion 1216 certainly is, as is clear from comparing it to its predecessor, Shake That Thing. And now, tight like that.
When you see my gal all across the hall, find another new kicking in my song. You know it's tight like that. She's a love on board, tight like that. She's a love on board, yeah, but don't sing. I need a tight like that.
In fact, the piece is startlingly modern. In some ways, it's like hearing the future. We can hear the dramatic beginning of the now ubiquitous stop time riff of the urban blues, the walking bass lines of early rock and roll, and the easy, relaxed swing of the city blues to come. At the same time, Tight Like That also represents a fusion of various styles of African American popular music. The form is a straight ahead 12 bar blues, though not in the traditional form as it appears here. Try to get backwater blues, that's what I teach. As my standard blues. Tight Like That, though, is what's called blues song form. Instead of the AAB form of the lyrics that we see here, first line, repeated, and then another line, blues song form uses a harmonically static four-bar verse and a more harmonically active eight-bar refrain. You can see that there are more chord changes in that second half.
Little black goose met a little brown hen, made a date at the barn about half past ten.
Now they were good. I love that.
Beat it up on board, tight back then.
Next to the
road, yeah, we talk to you. I need a tight back then.
Far from being unique, examples of this type stretch back into the pre-blues tradition and are reflected in ragtime, folk, country, and classic blues. One prominent example is hesitation blues, which Leadbelly estimated was from around 1910, and of course was later arranged for publication by W.C. Handy. The tempo, a surprisingly brisk 192 beats per minute, far outpaces most recorded blues of that time. While there are clear links to the ragtime feel of the Piedmont blues originating from Tennessee and Georgia, both its tempo and its driving four-to-the-bar feel more closely resemble Chicago jazz of the late 1920s, but also evoke the good-time feel of country string, jug, and washboard bands. And notice the text from the original Vocalion ad in the Chicago Defender. You'll say it's the catchiest and snappiest tune you've heard in a long, long time. Just the kind of tune that you'll keep humming and humming. Walking bass lines that forcefully carry the song into the refrain are clearly those of the just emerging boogie woogie piano style.
When you see my gal all across the hall,
right here.
Find another new beacon in my
soul. While not unprecedented in the blues, a nearly identical figure is heard in Blind Lemon Jefferson's Matchbox Blues, for example. Its use here as a bridge is both new and striking. Likewise, variants of the bold turnaround at the end of the refrain
and here's the turnaround
is heard on earlier records, but the implied harmonies are unusually sophisticated, really unprecedented in country blues. The dramatic stop time that's introduced at the beginning of the second verse, while originating in ragtime, sounds quite different here. The pickup riff that halts suddenly on the downbeat is far more reminiscent of contemporary jazz. It's also just the kind of, quote, little trick or embellishment, unquote, that Dorsey said he felt was really needed to bring a song over. Tampa Red's contributions. Sorry. There he is. Are equally significant. The introduction and the guitar solo demonstrate his prodigious slide technique, which earned him the nickname the Guitar Wizard and influenced legions of imitators, including Chuck Berry. His tone is equally striking. Tampa Red was the first black artist to record using a National Steel Body guitar, a very early Style 4 Spanish tricone, which he bought during the first production year for the sum of $195. He must have been a great busker. The long, smooth sustain of that guitar and the picture of just the guitar on the left, the guitar, in fact, was rediscovered about 10 years ago. And has now been restored. You can see it's the same one he's holding in his publicity photo. But it has a really long and smooth sustain that gives his playing a real visceral presence. This is his guitar solo.
I broke that tight like that. Yeah, thanks.
He's also quite a good singer. His voice is lyrical, like Barbecue Bob, Blind Blake, and other singers from the Eastern Seaboard, but I think it's most similar to the vocal style of Alani Johnson, Red's favorite recording artist. The lyrics as a whole, I'm gonna need to back up here for just a second, really have no exact predecessors, but many of the individual lines are drawn from older black musical traditions. For example, the phrase Beetle Bum, according to Dorsey, quote, was an expression they used in the dance joints and creepy slip-in places, smutty dives in the red light district. The gals would think those kind of suggestive words while dancing around with their fellows. More immediately, a young up-and-comer on the Chicago blues scene had recorded a song called Big Bill Blues the previous year for Paramount Records that contained a kind of familiar-sounding refrain. Evidence suggests the song was an instant hit, as a flood of cover versions quickly appeared on the market. The first by Georgia Tom and Tampa Red. Less than 3 weeks after the original version hit the streets of Chicago, the pair returned to the Vocalion Studios to record the song as Tampa Red's HOKUM Jug Band, with vocals by the popular vaudeville star and female impersonator Frankie Half Pint Jackson, issued as Vocalion 1228. Earlier that year, two acts on the Victor label, the Memphis Jug Band and Cannon's Jug Stompers, had produced solid hits, sparking a jug band craze. Now, jug bands don't normally include piano, but the rest of the instrumentation, kazoo, jug, woodblock, and guitar, convey really the same flavor, but with a decidedly urban cast. Here, the tempo is pushed to 212 beats per minute, perfect tempo for the Charleston, not coincidentally. The version has very few lyrics, and instead, Half Pint shouts encouragement to the band, finally delivering a simplified version of the chorus while Tampa Red plays the melody on kazoo. By several scat choruses and then a laughing chorus, reminiscent of Jelly Roll Morton's Laughing Blues and Hyena Stomp. The date for the session is occasionally cited as taking place on October 31st, 1928. Stamper Red's Hokum Jug Band was in the studio that day, but they recorded two different titles, one called Down in the Alley, and the other, Good Gordon Gin, issued as Vocalion 1254. Though to be fair, Good Gordon Gin does sound awfully familiar. On December 5th, Tampa Red and Georgia Tom again recorded the song, released as It's Tight Like That Number 2, Vocalion 1244, but with an entirely new set of lyrics. Less than a week later, they were at the Marsh Recording Labs in Chicago, accompanying Harry Jones and Papa Two Sweet, probably William Perry of the vaudeville team Long Willie and Lulu Two Sweet, on Honey, It's Tight Like That, which was released on OK. Another version with completely distinct verses, as is Georgia Tom and Tampa Red's It's Tight Like That Number 3, released as Vocalion 1418 on January 12th of the next year. Even while Georgia Tom and Tampa Red were still releasing versions of the song, which Dorsey, by the way, regarded as a really good way to chisel money out of the record companies. Don't have to write anything new, just go in and sing it again. Other ensembles began to record It's Tight Like That. On November 23rd, 1928, McKinney's Cotton Pickers cut a version, Vocalion 38013, followed on December 23rd by Walter Barnes and his Royal Creoleans, and the very next day by Jimmy Noon's Apex Club Orchestra with vocals by Junie Cobb. By early the next year, the song had spread beyond the confines of Chicago. On January 15th, 1929, Louis Russell and his Burning Eight were in the OK Studios in New York, waxing their version with Walter Pinchon. Another version was recorded by Zach White's Chocolate Beau Brummels later that year. And let me give you just a little taste of all of them. I think this is a good time to remind you that I am not a recording engineer, so I apologize for the rough cuts. Oh, great. Wait. Sorry, I'm reading it from here, and I'm on the wrong playlist. So. You want to tell me up, down?
Lower left, down.
Okay, I need to change playlists. This is the wrong playlist. Is that Eclipse? New playlist, yeah. Okay, you know what? We'll just skip it. I'll come back to it at the end, I promise. I always get lucky. We could only get it to show on one screen, my apologies. Jazz mashup, yeah?
Yeah.
Okay, there we go. Thank you. By that time, It's Tight Like That was a nationwide sensation. Big Joe Williams recalled that Tight Like That went out to just about every four corners of the United States, went through both races, white and black. You'd hear little kids mumbling it wherever you went. An article in the Chicago Defender on 23 November 1929 reported that everybody has heard Tight Like That and everybody has danced to it. The song has already sold 500,000 copies in Mr. Dorsey's original arrangement and words. On January 26, 1929, Clara Smith, one of the biggest classic blues stars of the era, cut It's Tight Like That for Columbia Records. Smith changes the form slightly. She expands that 12-bar structure out to a 16-bar strophe and introduces lyrics drawn from the sheet music published by Melrose Brothers in 1928, but that were never used by Georgia Tom and Tampa Red.
Mandalay Jones up a vamping at night, and she never get home till the coming daylight. Old Uncle Bill came out half past 10, put the key in the hole, but he couldn't get in. He says it's tight like that. What's the matter with it getting tight like that? Oh, hear me tell you, I mean it's tight like that.
Oh, wait, we're just getting started. It's with this recording that It's Tight Like That began to be viewed by anyone other than its creators less as a set composition than a malleable piece that could be altered, arranged, and adapted. This diversity is reflected in a number of versions recorded in 1929. Hilda Alexander and Mamie McClure convert the song into a morality play about a boyfriend who drinks too much and beats her. On April 1st, the Southern Blues Singers, accompanied by Cow Cow Davenport, cut a version for Jeanette that hews closely to the original lyrics of O'Kelly in 1216, but in a distinctly different arrangement. The next month, Eddie Mapp, James Moore, and Slim Barton, who Al and Sutton suspect is Hoke Rice, a hillbilly performer and sometime member of Gid Tanner's Skillet Lickers, recorded the piece as an instrumental for harmonica and guitar. In November, Otis Mote, a white vaudeville performer, recorded his version of It's Tight Like That in Richmond for OK Records. And we're going to attempt another clip mashup here. We're like Cow Cow, take it out. Companies lost no time in capitalizing on the popularity of It's Tight Like That. Paramount's race recording director, Althea Dickerson, brought an example into the studio called the HOKUM Jug Boys in December of 1928. Any similarity to the name of Tampa Red's HOKUM Jug Band was entirely intentional. As a matter of fact, the HOKUM Blues were Dorsey, Tampa Red, and Dickerson's husband, Alex Robinson. They couldn't record It's Tight Like That, which had been copyrighted by Williams' State Street Music and then sold to Melrose Brothers without paying royalties. Instead, the band recorded two tracks of a similar nature, Beetle on Bum and Selling That Stuff, though with the latter, similar doesn't really even cover it.
And Jane gave a dance and she had a crowd. And she's doing more whiskey than the law allowed. She's selling that stuff. Oh, Aunt Jane, she's selling that stuff. Just the thing. She can break your record when it comes to selling that stuff.
Titles had previously been recorded and probably written by Big Bill Brunzi and Frank Braswell as Big Bill and Tomps, neither had taken off. Again, Dorsey's arrangement seems to have made all the difference. Dickerson recorded that the record was a tremendous seller. The Hokum Boys, with shifting personnel, continued to record for Paramount until the late 1930, and I have a list there of some of the Hokum Boys. The success of selling that stuff unleashed a torrent of its tight like that imitations, including Hey Mama, It's Nice Like That, Parts 1 and 2 by Jim Jackson, Bogus Ben Covington's It's a Fight Like That, Barbecue Bob's She Moves It Just Right.
She moves it just right. She moves it just right. Everybody crazy, cause she moves it just right.
Ed Macon and Tampa Joe's Ringing That Thing. John Bird and Washboard Walters, 38 and Plus.
I got a key, shine like gold. The women all tell me satisfied their soul.
That's not really a key, by the way. And the Memphis Jug Band's Tappin' That Thing and Bottle Up and Go, which would spurn its own list of derivatives. Versions of It's Tight Like That, as well as the aforementioned derivatives recorded before 1930, are really best considered a song family. But Georgia Tom and Tampa Red's hit was not, in fact, the starting point. Remember, it was based off the melody of Papa Charlie Jackson's Shake That Thing. And this association is highlighted by a recording called Hometown Skiffle, Parts 1 and 2, released on as Paramount 12886 in 1929, a descriptive novelty number featuring Blind Lemon Jefferson, Blind Blake, Will Azell, Charlie Spann, the Hokum Boys, and Papa Charlie Jackson. Part 1 opens with Alex Hill playing a version of Jackson's Shake That Thing, and other artists contribute brief snatches of material in a similar vein. Part 2 opens with a single 12-bar chorus by Blind Lemon Jefferson, who is in fact never named, followed by the Hokum Boys singing a portion of Selling That Stuff, Charlie Spann playing Soon This Morning, whose origin suddenly becomes extremely clear, and then finally a recapitulation of Shake That Thing by Jackson himself. So we'll start with the Hokum Boys.
They took Aunt Jane to the county jail. She didn't need nothing to go her bail. Oh, she's selling that stuff. Old Aunt Jane, oh, she sold that stuff. Just the same.
She could really break the record when it came to selling that stuff.
Hey, hey, ain't that... Nah, nah. You're the man trying to get away with something. Come on, Charlie Spann. Play one of those old blues for us. Play Soon This Morning.
This is Charlie Spann himself. Enjoy.
Yep, and then a little Papa Charlie.
Because here's Papa Charlie here bubbling over. He's the composer of Shake That Thing. Play it, Papa Charlie.
Down in Georgia, dance that's new. Ain't nothing to it, it's easy to do.
That's the Cops, by the way. Seriously. Tight Like That is far from the only song derived from Shake That Thing. The most immediate and probably the most famous is Georgia Grind, composed by Spencer Williams several months after Shake That Thing was released. It was first recorded by Clarence Williams' Blue Five on December 15, 1925, by Ethel Waters a week later, and the next year in February by Louis Armstrong and his Hot Five. Others in this song family include Diddy Wah Diddy, recorded first by Blind Blake and soon after by Barbecue Bob as Diddle Da Diddle. We'll listen to a little of Blind Blake.
A little girl about 4 feet four. Come on, Papa, and give me some more of your Diddy Wah Diddy. Your Diddy Wah Diddy. I wish somebody would tell me what Diddy Wah Diddy means.
Also, Giving It Away by J-Bird Coleman and his Memphis Jug Band, Wipe It Off by Lonnie Johnson, Lovin' Sam Threads, She Scuffles That Rough, Al Miller and his Market Street Boys, Somebody's Been Using That Thing, also recorded by the Hokum Boys, Lucille Bogan's Struttin' My Stuff, She's Got Good Stuff by Charlie Spand, the Memphis Jug Band's Move That Thing, and You Gotta Have That Thing, Roosevelt Sykes's We Can Sell That Thing, and Walter Coleman's Smack That Thing, literally to cite only a few. As Paul Oliver has quipped, there are dozens of songs from this period that, quote, leave the exact thing or stuff for the listener to decide. It might be whipped, tapped, bothered, or used, but never defined, unquote. They also all have another thing in common. Suggestive lyrics, and of a variety that's not reflected by the similarity of titles, indicating a deep well of material from which to draw. It has been suggested that this flood of double entendre Hokum blues was a contrivance or plan of the recording industry. Michael Harris states, quote, it's unclear why Vocalion would begin to record these songs, except that the record companies dictated tastes by deciding what they would like to market. Max Jones expressed a similar view, quote, instead of a variety of blues speaking in simple and unashamed language of the different phrases of existence, the record companies now contrived to issue a succession of blues and near blues, notable for their innuendo rather than poetic imagery, unquote. I could cite dozens more. All suggest that these songs, with their evocations of vaudeville and the medicine show, sexual innuendo and their rambunctious character, betrayed the meaning of the real blues and thus couldn't have been the conscious choice of performers. Evidence suggests otherwise. As Mel Watkins points out, quote, while the blues were never specifically a comic form, it was no stranger to irony and satire. The expressive focus was usually financial or marital woes, social injustice, or the perfidies of sexual relationships, but woven throughout are the typically earthy, candid lyrics are examples of wit and amusing observations lifted directly from an underground reservoir of black humor. These records represent kind of a twilight zone between blacks' public and private postures. Knowing that their audience would be primarily black, performers could and did loosen many of their inhibitions, unquote. Now, It's Tight Like That was far from being the first double entendre blues. Just a casual glance at the repertoires of classic blues singers, medicine show songsters, vaudeville performers, and country juke musicians, as well as other black entertainers, reveals a large number of such songs. While really far less raunchy than many of its successors, It's Tight Like That is part of that underground tradition of blues songs extending back into the early years of the 20th century. The success of the track seemed to have signaled that a larger scope of material was not only purple, but profitable to record, and that songs that had remained in the recesses of black culture began to pour forth. And as Speckled Red has stated,
Back in when they was making records back in the day, you could say some little smutty words and they wouldn't think nothing of it. But it's a whole lot different now.
It has long been acknowledged that an unrecorded tradition of obscene material was part of the black musical lineage. Harold Odom and Guy B. Johnson stated in their The Negro and His Songs from 1925, it's to be regretted that a great mass of material cannot be published because of its vulgar and indecent content. These songs tell of every phase of immorality and vice and filth. They represent the superlative of the repulsive. They are sung in groups by boys and girls, men and women. Children of 10 or 12 know scores of them, varying in all degrees of suggestiveness. Often, these songs are their favorites, unquote. In 1912, the African-American vaudeville veteran Paul Carter commented in the Indianapolis Freeman that, quote, smutty sayings and suggestive dancing, unquote, was already endemic in black vaudeville, and patrons most favored, quote, a little smut and things with a double meaning, unquote. Some evidence of this tradition has survived via anecdotes and on records made... And on records made by vaudeville comedy teams in the mid-1920s, or some of them during the blues revival of the 1960s. The latter was the case with Butterbeans and Susie's I Want a Hot Dog for My Role, a song so ribald that OK Records refused to release it.
What is it? I'm here to pay. Satisfy me. Listen while I say.
What have you got to say?
I want a hot dog for my role.
Well, here it is, here it is. Dog's never cold.
Give me a big one, that's what I say. I want it so it will fit my bread.
Now here's a hot dog.
Many comedy teams trafficked in this type of repertoire, including the aforementioned Willie and Lulu Too Sweet. One of their showstoppers was Keep It Up All the Time. And my very personal favorites, Coot Grant and Kid or Socks Wilson, who recorded items from their stage repertoire such as Can I Get Some of This?, She Sure Shakes a Mean Ash Can, Big Trunk Blues, which Paul Oliver considers one of the truly splendid pornographic blues of all times, and I Ain't Gonna Give You None, reworked in 1933 as Lollipop.
I know you want it.
I sure do.
Oh, it looks so good.
It do.
I wouldn't give you a piece, honey, if I could.
Now, Mary.
What?
You is making me blue.
Why, Willie? Cause I can't give none to you.
Mm-hmm.
I'll play ring around roses, even play hopscotch, but I can't give you none of my lollipops.
Yeah, you can.
Speckled Red told Paul Oliver about unexpurgated songs he performed in barrel houses like Ma Grinder and the Dirty Dozens, saying, quote, in those days and in them places, you could say some of them smelly words and not think nothing of it, unquote. Similar material, known for its bawdy vigor, was part of the repertoire of most songsters and blues singers. They included Salty Dog, Dirty Mother for Ya, first cousin to the Dozens, Sweet Petunia, also known as Sweet Toonie or Sweet Patootie, Shave 'em Dry, Stave and Chain, Uncle Bud, Just a Spoonful, and Shake It and Break It. All were recorded by various artists in the late 1920s and early 30s in sanitized versions, and all were eventually connected in their unexpurgated forms. The most famous probably being Lucille Bogan's 1935 recording of Shave 'em Dry, which is so raunchy, it still has the power to shock and titillate. And I'm trying to keep this PG, so I'm not gonna play. I literally couldn't find 12 seconds to play. If you haven't heard it and would like to, it's on my computer. See me after the session. B. Johnson reported in 1928, some of these songs of the Negro underworld have made the ascent to the realm of decency. In the lowest types of cabarets, they can still be heard in their original versions. Passing on up through the various grades of cabaret and vaudeville shows, they lose objectionable words and phrases until they finally become decent or indecent, as you will. With the exceptions of Spoonful and Shake It and Break It, all of these songs employ the blues song form. Moreover, they exhibit certain melodic similarities as well. I'm not suggesting that they're all derived from a single common tune, but their form, their narrow melodic range, their harmonic rhythm, the rate at which the chords change, and the extensive motivic and pitch repetition are characteristic of a stock formula, one that was probably applied to a wide range of blues texts. There's also a significant degree of lyric transference from one song to the next, as we can see in a few occasions in It's Tight Like That. We'll start with, there's a little black rooster made a little brown hen made a date at the barn about 10:30, a lyric that was originally collected in Texas by Thomas Gates in 1906 as the verse of a song called I Ain't Bothered, which Thomas stated was the resynthesis of a pornographic barroom ballad that was usually on the cards of whiskey drummers around the turn of the century. And we actually have a recorded version. Clara Smith uses this in almost exactly the same form in her version of Tight Like That.
The little red rooster fed to the hens.
This is very
you tall. Ain't laid an egg and I can't tell when. The little red hen fed to the rooster. Don't come around as a...
Oop, cut that off a little soon. Now, the gal I love, she's long and slim, and when she whip it, it's too bad, Jim. Now, the first of those lines is incredibly common. It appears in a number of blues, including Salty Dog and Sweet Petunia. But ultimately, the phrase is probably derived from the ubiquitous and scandalously filthy Uncle Bud, which Zora Neale Hurston recorded for the Library of Congress in 1939 with the verse, Uncle Bud's got a gal... Got gals that's long and tall, and they rocks their men from wall to wall. But I'm going to play a little bit of the beginning so we can hear her explanation about the song.
What is it sung for the respectable ladies?
Never. It's one of those juke songs. And the woman that they sing Uncle Bud in front of is a juke woman.
And,
yes, I heard it from her. Yes. Uncle Bud. A man like this, you can't get a woman gonna use his fist. Uncle Bud, Uncle Bud, Uncle Bud, Uncle Bud.
Okay, that's as far as we're going with that. Again, I've got the rest, if you'd like to hear it. Uncle Bud also makes an appearance in the song's most interesting couplet, I think, because it doesn't appear in any other version of It's Tight Like That, and it doesn't appear in the printed sheet music either. And it has stubbornly resisted translation up until a week ago when I happened to find a variant of it in Peg Leg Howell's Turkey Buzzard Blues from 1928. Uncle Bud and Aunt Jane went chinkapin hunting, chinkapins being chestnuts. Aunt Jane fell down and Uncle Bud got something. Another verse. Mom had a little dog, his name was Ball, and if you gave him a little taste, he wanted all, is drawn immediately from Big Bill Brunzi's Big Bill Blues, but the original, unexpurgated version is most probably the one used by Memphis Minnie in her New Dirty Dozens from 1932. And I'm going to tell you all about an old man, Bell. He can't see, but he sure can smell. I deliberately haven't really transcribed that out. There's another group of songs for which blue versions have been collected, but it can't be determined at this time whether they're the original unexpurgated version or contrafacts or retextings of familiar standards. This speculative group includes Ball and the Jack. Buddy Bolden was known for a spectacularly filthy version. The Hesitating or Hesitation Blues, and Keep a Knockin', which was recorded by Dorothy Trowbridge and James Bootlet Wiggins as Steady Grindin' in 1933. Another group of songs are clearly based on a formula, but their origin hasn't been determined. I'm calling them the I Ain't No X family and the What's That Taste Like / Smells Like family. An example of the first is Bo Carter's All Around Man, which includes the lyrics, I ain't no plumber, no plumber's son, but I can do your screw until the plumber man comes. The most infamous example of the second is certainly What's That Smells Like Fish by Blind Boy Fuller, but there are dozens of earlier versions, including Tampa Red's What's That Taste Like Gravy? And I bet you don't know, which is the next line. Songs of this nature, with humorous, ribald lyrics and up-tempo accompaniments that evoke the old-time string band and roll vaudeville, came to be known as Hokum Blues. It's commonly asserted that the term didn't have any particular meaning, which is what Thomas A. Dorsey told Jim O'Neill in 1975. Quote, yeah, well, I think we found that name. We heard it somewhere. We played up the name Hokum, seeing it worked. It wasn't no style. I don't know what they meant by Hokum. It was just a name we gave it, and it worked, unquote. Dorsey may have forgotten, but Hokum was an incredibly common term among vaudeville performers. A New York Times article from 1917 on vaudeville slang defined it as a brand of fun bordering on vulgarity and quite obvious. Hokum, it has been suggested, is a contradiction of hocus pocus or hooey and bunkum, so hokum. The term is still in surprisingly common use. Google it, seriously. And most dictionaries now define the term as meaning pretentious nonsense. But they also report that in the early 20th century, it was used as, quote, a device by showmen to evoke a desired audience response, unquote. What kind of response is suggested by other definitions that mention that it evolved elements of low comedy meant to provoke laughter with suggestions of frivolity, familiarity, and sentimentality, like an old naughty joke that you've heard 100 times, but it's still funny. In fact, it's hard to improve on Paul Oliver's description of Hokum as, quote, a minstrel show term for the good-natured guying of simple folkways that played on the city dwellers' ambivalent mixture of condescension and nostalgia for more innocent pleasures of rural life. The term must have still been current in the late 1920s for Vocalion to have billed the Red Dorsey Jackson Collective Tampa Res Hokum Jug Band. In fact, as far as I've been able to determine, the term doesn't previously appear in connection with recorded sound, with the possible exception of Jimmy Blythe's Washboard Band, which cut a track called Bohunkus Blues in 1926. And if Althea Dickerson recalled correctly, Dorsey knew exactly what the term meant. She claims he suggested calling the trio that recorded for Paramount the Hokum Boys, because this stuff is just pure hokum, unquote. On a general level, the Hokum Blues is a fusion of elements reflective of Chicago's musical culture in the late 1920s. Jazz, folk blues, vaudeville numbers, barrel house piano, classic blues, as well as these underground and less familiar musical traditions. In the densely concentrated area of the Stroll, musicians with different styles, professional backgrounds, and levels of musical training collaborated, which gave music originating from the city a distinctly varied flavor. While the style is distinctly urban, it's not, as it has been asserted, and doesn't indicate that Hokum Blues were musicians were, quote, suppressing their own subculture and acquiring the traits of the dominant white middle class, unquote. Rather, Hokum Blues reintegrated portions of African-American musical culture that had been deemed unfit to record by combining these elements with the dominant musical paradigms of the day, creating a style that was both modern and old-fashioned, urban and rural, with a broad appeal for a wide range of the black population, both those who remained in the South and those who, like Georgia Tom and Tampa Red, were relatively new migrants to the cities of the North. Thank you. Other questions? Yes.
Are you able to trace all the variants of the type like that in white string band traditional?
No. Literally up until 3 days ago, I kept finding them. There may be an infinite number. And I did not go very far into the string band tradition. I'm sure there's scads. Other questions? Any of you who are here, if there are any of those variants that I have missed that you know of, please, please, please come and tell me. I am trying to assemble the definitive collection.
How many do you
have? I have 20 right now. And I have 20, and I actually cut off at 1931. So I'm not even counting the Duke Ellington version. And there are a number of versions that emerge later in the 30s and the 40s, and the variants of the song run really all the way up to 1949, 1950. Really as long as Tampa Red kept recording. But I think I should also point out that he wrote It Hurts Me Too and a number of other fine blues. He was not a one-trick pony. He was just really good at that one trick. I think that's it. Thank you all. And like I said, if anybody wants to hear the unreleased Shave 'Em Dry, come see me.